Columbia. Church programs and stuff going on, but thank you all for being here, that you could come. I got to slip over and help the kids practice, but I'll be back at the end. We are trying to get, we had a few issues with a copy machine, but we will have your handouts by the end of worship. So anyway, let's just enter into worship. Also, one quick thing is we have offering envelopes on the back. So if you would like to give into Miss Raleen's ministry, everything that you give goes directly to her. And so the envelopes are on the back as you walk out, and there's a bucket back there. If you would like to give into that, that would be very greatly appreciated. And again, thank you all for coming, and let's just enter into worship and be receptive to what God has for us today.
Praise and worship Him, and let's set aside everything that might be on our minds today, and let's just come in unity together in one accord and worship the Lord today. Hallelujah. Lord, we just love You today. Lord, we just glorify and we magnify Your holy name, for You are worthy of all praise. You are worthy of all glory, Lord. Oh, You are high and lifted up. Lord, we just
know, praise and worship, I have different ones say to me, why do you have praise and worship at prayer time? And I said, because thanksgiving and prayer and worship is also prayer. And I said, it just gets your focus, you know, because there's so many things that we can get our focus on. Thank you, Jody. I'm going to have to sit today, but that's okay. But, you know, we get our focus on so many other things that, and then we come to prayer, and when we come to prayer, guess what? Those things that we've been focusing on are still there. And so I've always had praise and worship before prayer time, because that is a prayer also. Some people don't look at it that way, but you can have communion with Him in praise and worship. He can minister back to you. He can speak to you. And so I just love it, you know, for praise and worship. And thank you, Julia. I'm so thankful for Julia, you know, that she comes every month. She's such a blessing to us, and she's a blessing to Jody. And she's just been a real blessing. And we've known her since she's a little girl. But we've seen her grow up and mature into a beautiful woman of God. And so this is how God is using her at this time. And so you all may be seated. I really wanted to have prayer school this month because, you know, I've been staying home. I couldn't go out. I couldn't do nothing. But I did spend a lot of time in prayer and study of the Word. But I had such an urgency. It's really been in my spirit concerning corporate prayer, a call to corporate prayer, and the things that are going on around us in the world. And, you know, individual prayer, I love individual prayer. I've done it for over 40 years, you know, but corporate prayer, there's something about corporate prayer when you come together, is that it is so powerful because you are bringing your supply. Every single one of us bring our supply when we come to prayer. And in corporate prayer, we are actually connecting with one another to the point to where that everything that comes forth is done. Because we are in unity, we're in one accord, there is no schisms, there's no strife, there's no trying to be number one. We are all joined together as one. And so I wanted to go ahead and have it. And the Lord has given me strength to be here. Praise God, I'm 50% healed. My Lord is greater. He's more powerful than the enemy to where he tries to, you know, come against us. His word is more powerful than him. And it puts him on the run. And so I said, Lord, I know you're going to help me for this time, because to me it's a very important time today for this corporate prayer. And I want us to go. First, I want to say welcome to everybody that's watching online this morning. And I have some that are in Ethiopia, Ukraine, in Philippines, and in other places in the States. And so we just say you're welcome this morning. We're so glad you joined us. We believe this is the day that the Lord has made for us. And he has much he wants to inform us with. He has a lot that he wants to say to us today. And so we just say welcome. And so you join in with us when we pray. And so today the title of this that he gave me was a call to corporate prayer. He's calling for corporate prayer. He's calling for corporate prayer more so now than ever before that I've heard that call for corporate prayer. And it is because of what is going on around us, the days, the times that we're living in. And so when I just love corporate prayer, because, you know, some people just, you know, they haven't really stepped out, but when they start coming to like prayer school or come to a prayer meeting, then they come, and then what happens to them, those things that he has deposited in them, those giftings are there, then it starts to start coming forth that they are even amazed that that was all in them, but they never stepped out into prayer. And so we've had a lot of prayer answered. Praise God. How many of you remember when we prayed for a man? His name was Randy, and he had a liver transplant, and he was having some real issues with that. I got a text from his wife this week. They had to go back into Hot Springs, Arkansas, and they were running tests on him. And she sent me a text. She said, I want you to know and thank your church body, your prayer body there at your church for praying for him. We got good reports. And so she was just praising the Lord. She said, we knew that it was the Lord that touched him, and they were amazed when he got in from his previous test that he'd had to what the day that he went in. And then also there's a pastor's wife in Ethiopia. We prayed for her. Her name is Hamiet. And she was actually, they were wanting to do a hysterectomy on her. She had tumors, and so they were wanting to do a surgery. So she asked for prayer. And she was also a student in the Bible college. Well, I got a text from her. And she said, Raleen, I just want to say thank you and to your prayer, your church body for praying for me. She said, I went in and they did some biopsies. They were saying that it looked cancerous is what they were saying. And she said they came back with the reports. It is benign. Everything is benign. Now they are saying, you know, that they're just not going to go ahead and force surgery on her at this time. She did ask me, she said, continue to pray that fibrose tumor, that it just dries up. And I told her that we would. But there's just so many prayers that we've prayed that we've got the answers. Now, is that because we're somebody so special that God only hears us? No. It is because we've come together corporately and we've prayed together, joining together, and there is power. There is power in corporate prayer. I would rather be in the corporate anointing than the single anointing on my life, because the corporate anointing is so powerful. The reason for that is because when it's the corporate anointing, it is the full manifestation of the ministry of Jesus. I want us to go to Psalms 133 first this morning before we start out. And this new year that we are coming up with, he told me, he said, I want you to really focus in on our nation. This next year, I want you to focus in on the election starting in January, not starting the month before elections or waiting until 6 months into the year. He said, I want you to really focus in and stress that, is that to start praying. And so I told him, I said, I'll do that. So we are going to do that every month when we come together. We are going to start praying and focusing in on our nation, not only our nation, but also the election that is coming up. And we need to be in unity and one accord concerning a lot of things that are going on. So let's just have a word of prayer before we go into the teaching of the word. Father, we just come to you in the name of Jesus, that wonderful, glorious, mighty name. That name that's above every name in heaven and earth and under the earth. Father, we just thank you this morning for this day that you have made for us to rejoice and to be glad. But, oh, Father, it's a day that's full of you and your life and your mercy and your grace and your love. Thank you, Father, for this day. Thank you for calling us together with you today. And so we just thank you for all that you want to uncover and reveal to us through the Word of God. But Father, I thank you that you are going to reveal what's on your heart today, that you want us to pray concerning, to focus in on what's on your heart. And we know what's on your heart more than anything else is people. It is the church. And so I thank you this morning for everything that will be accomplished, that will bring glory and honor to you. thanking you for the Holy Spirit, who is the greatest teacher that we have, and that he leads and guides us into all truth because he is the Spirit of truth. And we thank you for the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you move and you minister and you teach this morning as you will. And we'll follow you and we'll yield to you this morning because you are the presence of God on the earth today. And we recognize you, that you're just not an it or a thing or something, a force or a power, but you are a divine person. You are God. And so we just welcome you today. We welcome you in the day, all day long, but today to begin in prayer school. And so you move and you minister as you will. And Father, we'll be sure to give you all the praise and the glory and the honor, for it's all in the name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Let's go to Psalms 133. I love this psalm because it talks about unity. And corporate prayer means that you are in unity and you are in one accord. You have one focus, one goal. And so here in Psalms 133 in verse 1, I'm reading it out of the Passion Translation. It says, how truly wonderful and delightful it is to see brothers and sisters living together in sweet unity. Then he's going to start comparing in the word what unity is when the brothers and the sisters are living together in sweet unity. He says, it's as precious as the sacred scented oil flowing from the head of the high priest Aaron, dripping down upon his beard and running all the way down to the hem of his priestly robes. This harmony can be compared to the dew. Oh, my goodness. Have you ever woke up some mornings and you look outside and there's just all this dew upon the ground and you think, well, it didn't rain last night, but it's all wet. And so when he says here, he said it is compared, he said, to the dew. Well, I wanted to study some things about dew, you know, when dew falls and why it falls and how that it stays, but then it's gone. But did you know that the atmosphere has to be a certain way in order to have dew? It's not rain, but it's dew. And the atmosphere, everything in the atmosphere has to be correctly right. And so when I saw that, when I started reading about what dew is and how dew is formed and why it comes and it settles here upon the earth, it's heavenly. It's from the heavenly atmosphere, but conditions have to be just right. And if there's anything off, it does not happen. So the conditions in the atmosphere has to be just right and correct in order to have dew. Well, when I saw that, I went, oh, that's it. It is the atmosphere. Did you know that unity creates the atmosphere around us when we come together corporately and the devil fights corporate anointing? He fights corporate prayer. He does not want it because he knows that it is unity that creates this atmosphere. It's like it has to be a certain condition. Well, that's what corporate prayer does. That's what unity, us coming together in unity and one accord. The atmosphere is created and it is just right for unity and love to flow as we come together and as we pray together. This is more detailed that I think we fully grasp and understand. I have been a prayer for over 40 years, but in my latter years, it's just continually being in the Word, studying the Word of God, you know, being a prayer, and the Holy Spirit is opening up and quickening up And just the Word of God, you know, there's things in the Word that we haven't even begun to touch on. But this is an area that the days that we're living in, I don't know if you all, I heard this because I was checking my phone, and it was Fidelis. And it was at healing school. And he made this statement on Facebook to the people that he was ministering to. And he said that the Lord had spoken some things to him. And he said, and he kind of held on to it, but he was now going ahead and giving it. But he said that the Holy Ghost told him that we are in the days we're living in, that there is the enemy, is the devil is mad because he knows that his time is short. And so he said that we as Christians are going to have to be strong in the Word. We're going to have to be in the Word. We're going to have to know who lives in us, because in these days it's being turned up. And he said that the Lord showed him there were going to be more attacks, there were going to be more accidents, all these things upon the believers. Well, you know what? I don't have fear. I don't carry fear. Fear does not, I don't have fear. I fear comes from the enemy. And the way that you don't have fear is through the Word of God, knowing God says who you are in Christ. So when he said that, he said, in other words, he didn't want them to be fearful, but he wanted them to be aware of what is taking place. Now, we know that the devil, he's always been around. We've known that. He's always been against the church. He's against the believer. He's against the Word of God. He's against the anointing of God. So we know that. We know that he is our enemy. We've recognized that. And he doesn't have anything new. But we can know that in these days that we're living in, the one who lives in us is greater than he that's in the world. And that became a revelation to me a long, long time ago. It went off like a light bulb on the inside of me, because I would go around my house confessing, you know, greater is he who lives in me than he that's in the world. The greater one lives in me. And one day I was thanking the Father. I said, Father, I thank you that the greater one lives in me, and he's greater than he that's in the world. And when I said that, it was like a light, just like it bursted on the inside of me, and I went, yeah, he's greater than he that's in the world. He's greater than sickness and disease. He's greater than poverty. He's greater, and he lives in me. From that day forward, no one could talk me out of that truth of God's word, because I knew the greater one lives in me, and he's greater than he that's in the world. When Fidelis was given that word, and I went, oh, but the greater one lives in me, and he's greater than all of this stuff that he's trying to conjure up, what he's trying to do. So anyhow, I do know that we need to be very sensitive to the Spirit of God in these days that we're living in. But we don't have to have fear. Fear should not be what motivates you to get into the Word of God or to pray. Or that should not be the motivation for you to get into the Word and to pray. Because fear is of the devil. And it does not belong to you. And when we sing that song, My Fear, I don't even sing my fear. I say, fear has no more. It doesn't have a hold on me. I don't sing my fear because I don't have fear. It's not my fear. It's the devil's fear. And you might think, well, you're really getting picky this morning. No, let me tell you, that's me. And that's me personally. And I am not going to sing my fear because it's not mine. It's not yours. It belongs to the devil, okay? I know some like that song, but that's okay, you know. But for me, it's not mine, and I'm not going to sing it. I'm not going to declare it that it is, because it belongs to the devil. So then he goes on down here, and he says that this unity or this harmony that we have can be compared to the dew. So that's saying then that this unity, this harmony is what creates the atmosphere in order for this dew, in other words, for the anointing, the corporate anointing. It is the atmosphere that is created when you and I come together in unity and one accord. He says, it goes on down, he says, dripping down from Mount Hermon, which flows down upon the hills of Zion. Indeed, that is where Yahweh has decreed his blessings will be found, the promise of life forevermore. He said, indeed, that is where Yahweh has decreed his blessings. He said, it's in that dew, that harmony, that unity. He said, he compares it to the dew that comes from Mount Hermon, and it flows down the hills of Zion. He said, this is what Yahweh has decreed. This is where he decrees his blessings. And then it says, his blessings will be found, the promise of life forevermore. When I read this, I studied this out in Psalms 133, that, you know, it's talking about Aaron, who was the first high priest. But did you know that our high priest today is Jesus Christ? He's our great high priest. And so when I was studying that and reading that, it was like the Holy Spirit was saying, Raleigh, that same anointing that is upon Jesus, that flowed in him and through him and upon him, when you come together corporately in unity and one accord, it's that anointing of our great high priest that flows up on him, the head, but it's flowing down to every part, every member of the body of Christ, even down to the very feet. And he said, and this is what happens when we come together in corporate prayer, is that when we come together corporately and in unity and one accord, what begins to happen is that when we get into that prayer with the Holy Spirit leading and guiding and directing us in prayer corporately, that anointing begins to flow. That anointing is flowing from the head of our high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the great high priest. And it's flowing from him unto every single one of us. And so this is what happens when we come together corporately. The more you pray together, the more you're connected together, the more you are flowing together, there is a very strong anointing in prayer. And that's what you want. You're not praying out of your head. You are praying out of your spirit man. It comes from your spirit man, from your heart. And so there is this flow that begins to flow out of us when we are together corporately. One will begin to pray out what they have in their supply. And then we begin to pray together. This is where we see things happen quickly. And the more you're together and the more you're connected together and joined together and corporately praying, then this is where that anointing begins to flow in prayer. And oh my goodness, if you've been in that place, you want to be there all the time. Prayers are quickly answered. You know, when we were in Tulsa, when we started it in Tulsa, you know, Bart was coming, and Bart is a witness. Aren't you I'm so thankful I've got witnesses everywhere I go, because I can get up and share things with you, and you might think, oh, she just, you know, oh, yeah, sure, Raleigh. But I've got witnesses, and that's what is so great is when you have witnesses. But I remember one time we were in corporate prayer, and it was my daughter-in-law's sister, Wanda, and she had been in a coma, and she was in the hospital, and my daughter-in-law had called and asked for prayer. We prayed for her that day. You remember that part? And we prayed for her that day, and I went, Wanda, in the name of Jesus, wake up, Wanda. You wake up in Jesus' name. And then Bart told me, he said, Raleigh, when you said that, that was coming out of my mouth, Wanda, wake up. That's the unity in one accord. You're flowing together in the Spirit. We know we didn't even leave the place, and I get a text from my daughter-in-law, and she said, "Raleen, Wanda woke up." Hallelujah. This is how powerful corporate prayer is. And it's not to be taken lightly or just something that we get to do or something else that the church has. No, this is the plan of God. This is His plan. This is His purpose. And this is why that Jody and Pastor Mark, I know Jody, she said, "Raleen, we want you to come here. We want you to come here to the school. We've made it a part of the Bible school." Because it's not just our plan or our purpose, but it is so that you and others can understand what corporate prayer is and how powerful it is. And so there are those that God's going to connect you with to pray together. I don't pray with just everybody. And I'm not going to get into all those things either this morning, but I don't. Because we're not in unity and one accord. There's flaky stuff going on. There's things that's not even scriptural. I don't join with them. I've been asked to come to Bible, to prayer groups, but I won't go. I won't connect with them because it's not scriptural. And so I want to stay with the Word of God, what the Word of God says. So what is corporate prayer? What would you say if somebody asked you, "What are you talking about when you say corporate prayer?" Corporate or united prayer is when believers come together in corporate unity of spirit, harmonizing together in prayer. So it can be just only two people. It doesn't have to be a large number of people. I've seen prayers answered and when there's only been four or five. But the reason for that is because of being in unity and one accord, you know, and flowing together, quickly seeing prayers answered. It doesn't have to be a certain number of people. It can be two or three together. But when you are in unity and one accord, there's a flow of the Spirit of God, and you'll be flowing and praying, and there's answers. Another thing. He told me to tell you all this morning. He said he already has the answer before you ask. And he took me back to the children of Israel. When they started crying out for him to come and deliver them. Well, before they ever started crying, he already had the answer for them. He had Moses. And so he says, "Tell them, I already have the answer before they ask." And he always, remember this, he always speaks the end from the beginning. He already, when he speaks it out, he already sees the end being already fulfilled. And that's why that you can trust his word. What he says in his word, his promises, it's done. It's already done. Because he spoke the end at the beginning because it was already done. That's our God. That's our Father God. Amen. In Matthew 18:20, it says, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." You know, one translation says in the New Living Translation, it says, "There I am." There I am. When two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them, the King James. But in the New Living Translation says, "There I am." There I am the moment that two or three of you gather together. In the Amplified, it reads like this, "For wherever two or three are gathered, drawn together as my followers into my name, there I am in the midst of them." You all remember hearing this phrase, "United we stand, divided we fall." I remember hearing that as a kid, you know. But, you know, it is true. United together, we stand. We're strong when we're united together. If we're divided, we fall. Because why? Because there's no unity there. There's no one accord there. It's like nothing is standing. Nothing is really taking place. So divided, we fall. In corporate prayer, you do not want to be divided. You know, he showed me a long time ago. He says, because sometimes I've had bad attitudes. Anybody in here ever have bad attitudes? But I know when I have a bad attitude. And one day he told me, he said, if you don't change that attitude, Rolling, you're going to hinder the anointing. You're going to hinder the anointing in your life, and you're going to hinder the anointing with the whole body of Christ. And I went, oh, my gosh, I don't want to have that attitude. And he said, you better deal with it. You better get that attitude changed, Rolling, because you will actually, you'll break the anointing. There'll be no flow of the anointing. He said, not only in your life to flow with the anointing, but corporately as the church, as the body of Christ. And so I thought, well, I don't want to be there. Okay, Lord, I repent. I don't want that. And so it will hinder the anointing. It'll hinder the flow of the Spirit of God. So corporate means united in a body, a number of individuals who are empowered to transact business as an individual. In other words, as one. So when we come together corporately, we're going to come together and we are empowered to transact business as one. As one voice. When we're in a corporate prayer, we are one voice. We're not many voices. We are one voice because we are praying corporately in unity and one accord. You know, united corporate prayer brings powerful results. I've seen it. I've seen it over in my lifetime. It doesn't change the life of one individual, which it can. But it's not just only one individual. It affects entire groups of people. It can affect a church, a nation. I mean, when you come together corporately in prayer, it affects entire groups when you come together to pray. Real united prayer or corporate prayer can affect an entire church. It can affect a city. It can affect a state or even a nation. I have seen this over the years, the nation of Ukraine, you know, because I have the missionary there is a real good friend of mine, and I kept going back and forth twice a year there with him. And I am telling you what, that nation changed from the first time I went to Ukraine to where it is today. I talked with him just recently, and he told me, he said, Rolling, the church is strong in Ukraine. And he's been back 4 times since the war started. He's going back. And then he's ministering in the churches. The churches are still open. He said, it's the church, Rolling, that has kept Ukraine in the place where it is because the church is strong with the word of God. And so we know that that nation has been changed. And I told Wayne, I said, Wayne, you've been there for 25 years. And I said, what you've planted in that nation of Ukraine, you're seeing the harvest of it as you go into those churches. Even though they're still in war, even war is still going on around them, the church is still strong. It's strong with the word. It's strong with prayer. And so as we look in the Bible, we can see there's 3 different kinds of situations where united corporate prayer is necessary. Now, I know we've covered this before, but how many of you know repetition is the best teacher that we have? And we need to be hearing it over and over and over. And so it's during a time of crisis. And you know, sometimes I say, you know, prayer isn't just when crisis comes. You know, a prayer is fellowshipping and communing with the Father. It's carrying out His will upon the earth as we are in prayer. But many times, even Christians, they want to use their faith when crisis comes. No, faith is a lifestyle. It's a way of life. It is every single day. It's not just when crisis comes. But many times, Christians, if there's a real crisis, that's the only time they will come together to pray. But we see that in the Word of God in the book of Acts. And you know the book of Acts is the church. And so we know that this is exactly what the church, they had a crisis and they came together. In Acts 4:23 through 34, it says, "And being let go, they went to their own company." Do you know that leaped out to me one day, own company. And so what were they going to do? In other words, after they had been persecuted, you know, by the religious leaders, and that it says that they were let go. In other words, they were in jail. When they were let go, they went, where did they go? Immediately, it says they went to their own company. Do you have your own company? I have my own company. We're that company of believers. But that they immediately went to their own company and reported all that the chief priests and elders had said unto them. And when they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord and said, "Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who by the mouth of thy servant David has said, why did the heathen rage and the people imagine vain things? The kings of the earth stood up and the rulers were gathered together against the Lord and against his Christ. For of a truth against the holy child Jesus, whom thou hast anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate with the Gentiles and the people of Israel were gathered together. For to do whatsoever thy hand and thy counsel determined before to be done. And now, Lord," they're still praying. This is what they're praying. It says, "And now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto your servants that with all boldness they may speak thy word, by stretching forth thy hand to heal, and that signs and wonders may be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus." And when they had prayed, the place was shaken. It was their own company. It was corporate prayer. They were in unity and one accord. It was so powerful that it says that the place where they were assembled together began to shake. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spoke the word of God with boldness. And the multitude of them that believed were of one heart. Look at this. One heart, one soul, or one mind. Neither said any of them that aught of the things which he possessed was his own, but they had all things common. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. Neither was there any among them that lacked, for as many as were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the prices of the things that were sold. The key to effective united prayer is found. In other words, this is what the key is to effective united prayer. So we see that it was during a time of crisis when their brethren were faced with the opposition that was coming against them. But then they released them, and immediately it says they went to their own company because they knew they could go to their own company and they could pray. They could come together as one and pray together. And because they did, there was great results that took place because of that corporate prayer. In Acts 12, verses 1 through 7, we see Peter. It says, "Now about that time Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread." This was during a time of their feast, one of their feasts. It says, "And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quadrants of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison." But listen to this. It says, "But prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And when Herod would have brought him forth the same night, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. bound with two chains, and the keepers before the door kept the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise up quickly." And his chains fell off from his hands. This is what happened as a result of this corporate prayer. They were praying for him while he was in prison. And I've shared with you all about a pastor in Ukraine that actually walked right out. He walked out, and the church was praying for him. They never saw him. He walked right past. The door to his cell was open. The Holy Ghost woke him up and told him, said, "Get up and go out that door." And he tried to argue with the Spirit of God, saying, "But it's locked. I can't get out." He said, "I said, open up the gate and go out." And so this happened in Ukraine. I met that pastor, and he told me what happened to him. And you know, this is when the church was together in unity and one accord and praying while he was in prison. So the power of united corporate prayer stripped off Peter's chains. That's what stripped off those chains, was that corporate prayer as they came together. There are the times when the church today, you know, we're still the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, you and I today. And you know, there are times when the church today needs chain stripping power today over people's lives, you know, situations and circumstances that people in the church, that we come together and stand together in unity in one accord. I knew my church was praying for me. They started praying for me immediately that Wednesday night. And they have continued to pray for me. And when I went to the doctor's just amazed, you know, because I'm 50% healed. And, you know, to them, they think, you know, older people, you know, that their bones, it takes longer to heal, and their bones are brittle, and all this bunch of nonsense. But anyhow, he was amazed that I was already, my shoulder was healed 50% in 3 weeks. And he said, "I want you back in 2 weeks." And he said, "I expect to see 80%. And I went, 100% when I go back. But it's because of the church praying for me. They're corporately, they prayed for me. And so, you know, this is why that today when we start praying, even over people that have their reports are not good, fourth stage cancer. I don't know how many people we've seen on Tuesday mornings that we prayed for fourth stage cancer. I personally know two already that were actually healed. No more cancer cells. Fourth stage cancers. One individual, which was my husband's cousin, the doctors just said, "We can't do nothing. There's nothing we can do. No treatments, nothing." I'm telling you today, she is cancer free. No more cancer. We took it, I mean, we got a hold of that in prayer, and we began to pray. There's been others that with the prayer requests that's come in on Tuesday mornings. And I mean, they're healed. That is that united prayer, praying together as one for that. It was that we came together in unity and one accord. And because of that, that power was released, in other words, to totally set them free. That's what the church needs today. More so now, I believe, than any other time of the church age, because of the days we're living in, the end times. And we are in the very end of the end times. And so we need to come together corporately. When corporate mercy and forgiveness are needed, this is actually another for when there was a call for corporate prayer. And we see that in Ezra chapter 10. And actually, let's just look at verse 1 and 2. It says, "Now when Ezra had prayed and when he had confessed, weeping and casting himself down before the house of God, there assembled unto him out of Israel a very great congregation of men and women and children, for the people wept very sore." When it says the people wept very sore, it means that deeply. In other words, that it was heartfelt. And he says, Shechaniah, the son of Jael, one of the sons of Elam, answered and said unto Ezra, "We have trespassed against our Lord, our God, and have taken strange wives of the people of the land. Yet now there is hope in Israel concerning this thing." And then you go on down, and actually they came to the place where they knew, they repented as the whole body. They all repented. So they needed mercy and forgiveness. And just you read that later and see what happened because of the corporate prayer. Another place that where I liked is 2 Chronicles 20, verses 13 through 18. And they needed guidance. Did you know that there's times when you, as a group, that we need guidance? We need guidance on different things. And, you know, here we see in 2 Chronicles, we see that Jehoshaphat, there were three armies that had come against the children of Israel, and they needed guidance. They needed to know what they were to do. I said, aren't you thankful that this leader, first of all, he went to the Lord and called, he called a fast and he called a time of prayer, and all the people came together. And it says in verse 15, it says, and he said, well, let's look on up here. It says, then upon Jehaziel, the son of Zechariah, the son of Benaiah, the son of Jael, the son of Mattaniah, a Levite of the sons of Asaph, came the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation. This is while they were praying. This is when they were together as a group praying. And it says, and while they were, the Spirit of the Lord in the midst of the congregation came upon Jehaziel. And he had a word from the Lord. He had a word from the Spirit of God. And he is the one who gave that word. This is what he said. He said, hearken ye all Judah and ye inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat. So we see it wasn't the King Jehoshaphat that got the word from the Spirit of the Lord. It was this man that was there, Jehaziel. He got it. Why was it, you know, when you look at some of these things, I always have questions when I study. I always ask the Lord, well, what about this? What about this? What about this? But you know what? It was, they were corporately together, and so that corporate anointing was upon all of them, and they were praying concerning this, what they were going to do about these armies. They knew they were already conquered, because there was no way that the children of Israel, their army was big enough to come against all these others that had joined together. And so they knew that they were already, they could not win. So they needed direction from the Lord. So that's when they all started praying. But the Spirit of the Lord came upon this one young man, and he heard by the Spirit of God. He said, do not be dismayed by reason of this great multitude, for the battle is not yours, but God's. Tomorrow go ye down against them. Behold, they come up by the cliff of Ziz. Even told them how they were going to come up. Did you know he can even today show us where the enemy's trying to come up against? This just happened with Israel last month. You know, that it was like they were coming in, they were coming by air and land, but they were praying. I'm telling you, there was corporate prayer going up everywhere for Israel that day when that was happening. Did you know the Spirit of God spoke and revealed where the enemy was coming in? They were coming in from the water, from the Mediterranean, coming through the coast to come to Israel, and they caught them before they ever got in and did anything. Listen to me. He does the same thing today. This is what he did. He chose, he spoke and said, this is where they're going to come. This is where they're going to come at. He said, they're going to come up by the cliff of Ziz, and you shall find them at the end of the brook before the wilderness of Jeruel. You shall not need to fight in this battle. Set yourselves, stand ye still, and see the salvation of the Lord with you. O Judah and Jerusalem, fear not, nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go out against them, for the Lord will be with you. Well, if he was with them, he's with you and I today. He's never left us. He said he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. And so he said, and Jehoshaphat, after he heard the word of the Lord, bowed his head with his face to the ground. And all Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem fell before the Lord, worshiping the Lord. So it wasn't even Jehoshaphat the king. And you know, this is what is so, I love the way God works. I love the way he works, the way he ministers. It is so powerful. It's just that, you know, he will use anyone who will be yielded to him, surrendered to him. And I just thought, here, you know, we think the pastor should have all the answers for us. You know, the pastor should be the one who's hearing a word from the Lord for us. You know, or one, a prophet. Well, I'm telling you what, today I know what prophets are called to do today. And they're not the same as in the Old Testament. But, you know, people, you know, Christians have this idea, well, I got to go to this one or to that one to hear from God, what God wants to say to me. No, no, you don't. He'll speak to you. And here he is in Jehoshaphat, the king. He was obedient to do, to call the people together to pray and to fast and to pray. But there was a young man in the group, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he spoke what the Spirit of God gave him to speak. This is when you know it's the Spirit of God. You know, when you come together, it makes no difference who God uses. Are you listening to me? This is where the corporate anointing comes in. And you'll never see the corporate anointing until you are in unity and one accord. And you start preferring one another and esteeming one another. And it's not all about you. Isn't that right, Jody? We traveled together. Listen, there were five of us on that pastor's wives team. All of us ministers. Look at me, look at me. Studied hours and hours to get our lessons ready. Oh, by sweat, you know, I mean, we, tears and sweat, we got, oh, we studied and got our lessons together. And I'm telling you, it took us 5 years. 5 years before we ever had the corporate anointing. I'm going to tell you, 5 years. Because we all stood behind the pulpit. We all had a call of God. We were either pastors' wives or we had been pastors. And so, you know, well, I've been behind the pulpit, you know. But he gave me a lesson. I remember that we were in Panama. And it was actually being in a corporate anointing is what it was. And it was like, if you want the corporate anointing, you've got to prefer one another and esteem one another better than yourself. And I was teaching it, and I even made this statement. I said, if Jeannie would come and tell one of us that we were not going to minister today, that it would be fine. She's the leader. She's the team leader. And if she told one of us that we were not going to minister today, that the Spirit of God was going another direction, I said we would say, okay. Well, it happened to my good friend Janine. And she came up to Janine and she told her, she said, Janine, you will not be ministering this afternoon. She said, because the Spirit of the Lord is going another direction. And you know, Janine, she's so sweet, so loving and sweet. And she said, okay, that's okay. She didn't rise up and say, listen, I spent all this money to come to Panama to preach and teach. I got my lesson prepared. I spent all this time doing my lesson, and I'm not going to teach today? No. She just submitted herself to the authority that was over her. And it began that day on that corporate anointing. I've thought about that, Jody, many times. If she hadn't, if Janine would have been upset in any way, that we would not have seen that corporate anointing. We never would have seen it. We saw things that, I'm telling you, I had never saw before. And it was that corporate anointing. They were, when the corporate anointing, you don't even have to lay hands on people. They are just healed. He's doing it. It's his ministry. He's doing it. We saw needs that were met all over that room. My friend Janine was plastered up against the wall. Her feet were this far off the floor. I am not exaggerating. This is the truth. Her feet were up like this, and she was plastered against the wall, and she could not get down. But I'm telling you what, that corporate anointing, it hit that day. There was a pastor that was a wife that was mentally, she was depressed. She was in such a state. And he heard about the meeting, and he brought her to that meeting. He had to bathe her. He had to clean her up. He had to, but he was bringing her to that meeting. And that woman, when she came in, he was carrying her practically in. That's how weak she was. And he sat her down in the back of the room. I will never forget this. I'll never forget it. But this is the corporate anointing. If you want to see the corporate anointing being manifested, there are keys that you must follow or you're never going to see it. You'll never see it. And but this woman, I'm telling you, that corporate anointing, it was powerful. We knew it was. Our friend Janine was plastered against the wall. And there, it just things, I mean, the Spirit of God was just moving all over that room. And this woman, she came from the very back. And there's like a middle aisle that was there. They had tables set up, tables and chairs on both sides. And we were at the head table, and there was the tablecloth that came clear down to the floor. She started down the middle aisle, and she was on her hands and her knees. She could not stand and walk by herself. And she came down to the front on her hands and her knees, and she'd come towards the front, and she would hit that tablecloth, and then she'd back up, and then she'd go back on her hands and her knees, and then she'd start back up again. She'd hit that tablecloth. That's how powerful the anointing was, that it even had an effect when she came up and just touched that tablecloth. And it was like we all just stood there. We were amazed at all this that was going on. I mean, it was like, oh, my goodness, look at her. We called her the Holy Ghost bumper car. Because it was like she'd come up and hit that tablecloth, and then she'd back. But she got up, healed, totally set free. Totally set free. And it was the corporate anointing. It was so powerful. And this is something that, oh, my goodness, I believe we're going to see it. But we, first of all, we have got to come to a place where that it's not all about us or how much experience we've had. That has nothing to do with it. It's a heart issue. It's a heart issue if you want to see the corporate anointing. And I truly believe we're going to see that more in these days that we're living in than we have before. But one benefit that we have praying with other believers is this. When we work together in the Spirit, giftings that have been hidden within us are revealed and activated. The anointing on us connects with the anointing on someone else. This is what's so exciting. I call you students, but it's like this is what is so exciting, because the anointing on us connects us with the anointing on someone else and enables us both to step into spiritual, listen to this, positions we could never occupy alone. And that is true. This is what, here at the Bible school, this is what we are stressing. We are preaching it. We're teaching it to our students because of the days that they're in right now, that they're being thrust out into the world. And we are stressing this with them over and over and over, because it's there, you'll go places together that you would never go individually. When you are connected, spiritually connected, in Proverbs 27, it says, let's go there. I want to read. It's in the, and anybody got the New Living Translation here this morning? Okay, Proverbs 27. Let me read it to you in the Passion. I have notes that I add as I go along. 17. Okay. It's iron sharpens iron. And the King James said, it takes a grinding wheel to sharpen a blade. And so one person, listen to this, sharpens the character of another. I love that. This is what he's talking about. When I got this, I wrote it down and said that what the benefit of praying with other believers is this. And this is what he said. He says, when we work together in the Spirit, he said, giftings that have been hidden within us are revealed and activated. Maybe it's never revealed to you or it's never been activated in you. And then the anointing on us, when we come together as one, the anointing on us connects with the anointing on someone else. And that is so true. That is so true. I love it. And enables us both. When that anointing is on someone else and it connects you and that other individual or two or three, when it connects you together, then all of you step into a spiritual position we could never occupy alone. Why is that? It's because their supply, your supply, joined together, is working together, that we are go into places spiritually that we could never go into individually. It connects us together. Be connected. And I said, you know, I truly believe this. I love to pray. I mean, I'm alone. I've always been by myself. And I'm sure all of you in here, you pray by yourself. But oh my goodness, now, today, the days we're living in, there's no time for that anymore. It's corporate prayer for what he wants done in these last days in the church, reaching out into the world. Spiritual connections and relationships are very important. Don't ever forget that. I am so thankful for all those that he connected me and my husband to when we first began. Jody and David were one of the first that we all were connected together. Look at us. We're still together. We're still flowing together. We're still ministering together. So spiritual connections and relationships are very important. They change us. They activate spiritual endowments within us. We can walk around for years with spiritual endowments and giftings lying dormant within us, like seeds in the ground. But when God sends somebody across our path who is anointed, did you know there's people in the body of Christ that are anointed to cultivate those seeds that are on the inside of others? And when these seeds in us will begin to sprout, when someone comes to us or crosses our path who is anointed to cultivate those seeds that are on the inside of us, the more we are with that person, the bigger those seeds grow. Oh, my goodness. All of us need the power of living divine connections with people that will carry an anointing to awaken people to the call. That is so true. That is so true. I've seen this happen over the years. It's so true. I said, I am so thankful. He always led us to people that were solid. Even my husband, he'd pray, thank the Lord. He said, Lord, I thank you that you always connected us with people that were strong and that had a firm foundation, that they weren't flaky out here and just crazy, doing crazy things. I thank you, Father, that you've connected us with them. I'm so thankful. You need to start praying that, Thank you, for Father, for connecting me with those who are solid, solid in the Word of God. Connections, divine connections, because God has divine connections. And these divine connections you will see through years of ministry. That's why I had that connection. It's for this time. And if you'll stay true to those connections and you'll stay connected one to another, that is one thing I always, with David and Jody, at John Lauer and Phyllis, there's a lot of them. I could name them off. That we were so connected, divine connections, but it wasn't, Jody, it wasn't just for that time. No. Woo, it was for all time. Because of that connection that we had, oh my goodness, what was it, 40 years ago? It's having an effect even today, even in between that time. So don't take it lightly when God connects you with someone. It's a divine connection of God, and it's for a purpose, His purpose, that He's got you there because it could be one who has that anointing to cultivate all those seeds that are on the inside of you, that God's put that in you. Oh, hallelujah. Well, let's get back. I just wrote those things down. It was just coming to me, and I went, oh, my goodness, that is so true, Lord. That is so true. And you're going through the years of ministry, and that sometimes, you know, you don't fully grasp the fullness of what He's doing and what His plan and purpose is. But in corporate prayer, there needs to be a leader. It's not anything goes. The leader must begin with clear instructions. And the leader's job is to discern the Holy Spirit's direction and to point the way for the prayers of those in attendance. The guidelines for corporate prayer is to maintain the same train of thought throughout the prayer time. This is why I say that prayer lists are for corporate prayer. It keeps you on track. You don't get over here on something else and everybody else is praying about this and that and everything that's not corporate, because you're not in unity and one accord. You're not praying for one specific thing. So this is what I heard Him say about today, is that he's calling for corporate prayer more now, more so now than ever before. And I always tell prayers, if you don't have a prayer group that you're praying with, ask him to show you who He's connecting you with. We have prayer time here at the church over here at Word Fellowship. You know, we have it on every other Thursday night. We have it every Tuesday morning. And that's your time. That's your own company. If you go to church there, or if you don't go to church there, you know, you can still come. We welcome you to come to prayer. And so there is finding a prayer group that God has ordained for you. Don't be just this lone ranger out here pulling yourself away from those that He's called you to be a part of, because there's power there. There's benefits there. There's so much more there when you are connected, divine connections together. Oh, my goodness. I love it. Okay, well, I gave you a sheet of paper, and I have more I want to give you next month, but I can't type right now, so I couldn't type it up. But I gave you a sheet of paper on prayer points for 2020 election. 2024. I'm sorry. Oh, my goodness. That's already passed and gone. Okay, this is for 2020. Do you have that on yours, 2024? No, 2024. Oh, golly, Raleen. But anyhow, here are the prayer points for the election that's coming up next year. And these are good, because we will also have some prayers, and I'll print those out for you. But number one is the divine plan and purpose for America will be fulfilled, and God will give us godly leaders. This is one of the prayer points that we want to pray for the election. Number two is that truth will be revealed and all evil schemes will be thwarted. Number three, that righteousness will prevail and they will elect godly leaders. You know, different states. We can put, I put some states in here, but we can put different states in here. Number four, that the Lord will navigate the hearts of the leaders to his purpose and plans for America. And I believe we'll be in right scripturally sound when we start praying this way. I've got scripture in here for you. Father, the Prince of Peace, his government and peace will never end. He will rule with fairness, justice from the throne of his ancestor David for all eternity. The passionate commitment of the Lord of Heaven's armies will make this happen. In other words, just actually, these are points for the election. And then next month when we come together, I will have other things for you for the election, for our nation. And I'm just have a real strong witness that we've got to. We have to. If we're going to just sleep and just be, you know, not doing anything, then when the election comes and then you think, oh my gosh, I got to pray. And it's maybe you've got 2 weeks to pray before. But he told me this. He told me this in October. He said to start praying now for the election in our nation. Our nation needs change. God knows it. God knows exactly what our nation needs. And so he said, start praying now, Rawling. Don't wait for a month before or the month of November. Start praying now for the election. So I believe that's what we're going to do. Amen. And this is going to be, I know that Pastor Mark and Trish, that they will be doing the same thing on Tuesday mornings and praying for our nation and the election. Now, we do have some prayer requests this morning. My granddaughter, Shauna's youngest boy, Carson, was in a car wreck last Saturday night with one of his friends. And his friend was driving his car. And they went off of 412 and got on gravel road because they were going to his aunt's. The family, they were all going there for a get to get Christmas thing. And so Carson was with them and he lost control, hit gravel and lost control and hit a tree head on. It has broke his ankle. It's completely broke. Shauna said his foot was laying to the side. Well, they could not get him into a surgeon this last week. And so they finally got an appointment and the first opening was this next week. So I want you all to pray for him. He's been in a lot of pain. They give him Tylenol and ibuprofen is all that the doctor will give him. And he's in a lot of pain. And he got, with his seatbelt, he got burned across his chest from where the impact was so strong. And then he had whiplash. So I'm going to ask you to pray for him and that the surgery will be successful. And then also Erlene's sister-in-law is going to have surgery for gallbladder, right? What's her name? Samantha is her name. And she's supposed to have surgery with her gallbladder. We want to pray for her. I want us to really pray concerning our borders. I've had this real strong since October, the borders of our nation. You know, we pray. I think what really showed me something, you know, we pray for the north border and the south border. But I don't think we spend as much time praying concerning the coastline. And this is something that I just thought, oh my goodness, we need to start praying for our borders, the coastlines and the north and the south, because this is what is how they're coming in. Now, my friend Carol, who is the director of the Bible College in Arkansas, sent me a text. This was last weekend. And in Fayetteville, Hamas started, they were having like a riot in the downtown square of Fayetteville, Arkansas, against Israel. it was open and they were rioting against Israel. And so she texted me and she said, Raleen, pray about this. She said, this is something that they're really getting bold about, you know, that they're right in the Times Square of Fayetteville, Arkansas, and it was nobody knew that this was going to happen until it happened. And so she told me to continue to pray because it is Hamas, and they are in Arkansas. They're very bold, and they're declaring this. They are rioting against Israel. And so she said, pray for this, Raleen, because this is really serious. And so I know that it is. So I'm just asking you all that we're going to, you know, pray for our borders and also for this that's going on in Arkansas. If it's going on in Arkansas, it's in other places too. So we need to be sensitive. We need to be sensitive to what's going on. And the Holy Spirit will reveal those things to us. He'll reveal even where they're at, different places where they're at. And so I know he does. I know he does. He can reveal and uncover where things are, you know, where people are. The Holy Spirit is that he's not limited. You know, I think sometimes we limit him, but he's not limited in revealing and uncovering dangers and things that are trying to come against us, and that we need to really be sensitive to the Spirit of God. So praise God. Father, we're just so thankful today. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for just, oh, the Holy Spirit revealing and uncovering the truths of your word concerning corporate prayer. Father, we long for that. We desire that more than anything else, Father, is that corporate anointing in ministry, in prayer, in relationships. And so, Father, today we just want to thank you for revealing unto us through the Holy Spirit and your word those things that you're wanting to speak to all of our hearts. Because, Father, these truly are, we know, the days, the end of the end days that we're living in. But you saved us for such a time as this, for this time. And so you knew that we would heed to what you're speaking to our hearts, how you're leading and guiding and directing us, Father, calling us and drawing us into one body and one voice, in unity and one accord, because there's many things I know by the Spirit of God that's on your heart that you want us to pray. For you're always ready. You're always ready to help us to pray. You're always ready to reveal and uncover truths to us. And so today we want to yield ourselves to the Holy Spirit, who is our help. Is that anointing that abides within us and upon us, and who have made us able ministers. And I thank you for that, Father. Thank you for this group that has come today, Father. I thank you for each and every one of them, that they came expecting to receive from you. They just didn't come just to come to some other meeting, but they came because they wanted to hear from you. So I thank you, Father. What you've got planned and purpose for this group. I thank you what you have planned and purpose for the church. We see it in your word. But Father, we know that there is even divine direction that you want to give to the church in this hour and day that we're living in. So we thank you today, Father. And we thank you that we can stand in the gap for other people. As we pray this morning, Father, we just want to lift up Carson to you. And oh, Father, we know that Jesus is already his healer. We thank you, Father, that your word says that by those stripes on Jesus' body that he was healed 2,000 years ago. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you that the right surgeon was handpicked for Carson. And that, oh, Father, as he goes in for surgery this next week, Father, I thank you that it'll just be done correctly. Nothing hindering for Carson's surgery. And And Father, that the pain, we just speak to that pain and command that pain to cease in his ankle, Father. And I thank you that he's a mighty young man of valor. Father, that he was born at your time for this time. And so I lift up Carson to you right now, Father, even today, that pain is leaving his body, his foot, his ankle, his leg, his body, his neck, every part of him, Father. And I thank you. I'm so thankful, Father, for the protection that was upon him. That, oh, Father, the angels of the Lord were encamped around that vehicle, around those boys. And I'm so thankful, Father. I'm thankful for that. So I thank you for just ministering to Carson today at home, and that he's going to have a quick recovery. He'll be able to do what he's always done before, Father, that there'll nothing be hindering him, in Jesus' name. And Father, for Samantha, we lift her to you also, Father. We pray for Samantha and her surgery as she's going into surgery. Father, we just thank you for the doctors that are handpicked for her as we pray. Those who will pray before they do surgery. Those who know who Jesus is in their life. And Father, I thank you that through even all this that she's going through, I know that the light of the glorious gospel is going to shine forth to her. In Jesus' name, Father, we thank you. What the enemy meant for evil, that you're turning this around for your glory and honor, Father. We know that you didn't cause any of this, but we know who did. But you are turning it around, what the enemy meant for evil, and you're turning it around for your glory. And so we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. And Father, right now we want to pray for our nation. Thank you for this nation, the United States of America, Father. Oh, it's a great nation. It was built and established upon the principles of the Word of God. Father, I just pray for our nation that, oh, that even those who stand for truth and righteousness are being placed into positions of authority all over this nation. And they will not bow down. They will not back off from what they believe in your Word, Father. And I just thank you as we pray for our nation is a nation that was established and built upon the principles of your word, Father. That our founding fathers were those who desired to have freedom of worship unto God. And Father, what they established by the Spirit of God for our nation. And this is the greatest nation upon the face of this earth. And we know Israel's parallel with the United States of America. And that, oh, Father, that our nation stands for truth and righteousness. It's returning back to what it was established and founded upon, and that was your word, Father. Cool. And as we face this new year, Father, as we pray about this new year, we know that you already know ahead of time. You have foreknowledge. And in your foreknowledge, you saw this time. You've seen all this time that we've walked through. But you've always been with us. You've never left us. You've never forsaken us. You've never left our nation. And so we know in your foreknowledge that this new year that's coming forth, that in this new year, you already see the plan. You already see things that have already taken place. So, Father, we trust you today. We trust you. Our focus is upon you, about our nation. And so we pray that your word declares that a nation, huh, that our nation is built and established. And what has been changed will go back. Will go back to what it was originally changed. And Father, I thank you for that. I thank you for our nation. I thank you as we pray over the elections for next year. We want the right one in there. The one that you want in there, Father. Not so necessarily the man we want in there, but it's who you want in there. And I thank, Father, that we've missed it at times when we prayed concerning elections because it was all about the man we wanted. But, Father, today our eyes are open to know that you know exactly who's to be in that position, that high position of authority in our nation, the president. And so we're trusting you as we just pray and we ask you, Father. You said you already had the answer before we ask. So we just thank you. We thank you for your answer that you have for our nation. And we pray for our borders, Father. Father, I thank you that in these days that we're living in, that that heavenly host, the angels, are working with the church. For we are the army of the Lord, and they're working together with us in these last days. And Father, I thank you for our protection around our borders, the north and the south, and even the east and the west coast. Father, I just thank you as we just declare that our borders are established and they're strong. They're strong borders. And I thank you for placing men and women around our borders that are strong in the Lord and in the power of your might, Father. I thank you that even the plan of the enemy, that it'll be revealed before it even happens. I believe those are the days we're living in, Father. And thank you as we come together in prayer today. We thank you and praise you and glorify you because you are raising up a mighty army in these last days. An army of prayers that won't back down, that'll stand strong, upon the principles of your word and the promises of your word, Father. Oh, a mighty army. Father, I thank you for the weapons that you've given unto us as the army of the Lord. And these weapons, they have divine power. They're not carnal, but they have divine power to the pulling down of strongholds, demolishing, oh my goodness, demolishing those things that are evil. I thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus for these weapons. I thank you for the name of Jesus, that name that's above every name. Every knee shall bow to the name of Jesus. I thank you that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. I thank you that that is a supernatural weapon, his name, that is full of power and authority and victory. Thank you for giving us that divine weapon of the name of Jesus. Oh, there's no other name. The name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, that he's given unto us the power of attorney to use his name upon the earth. I thank you for the name of Jesus. We stand against the enemy with the name of Jesus. And Father, I thank you for the word of God. The word of God that is our divine weapon. It is a supernatural weapon. Oh, I thank you for it right now in Jesus' name. And that word is settled in heaven forever. That word is alive and full of power and authority and victory. And authority, your final authority, Father. And we thank you for the word of God. And no weapon formed against our nation is going to prosper. No weapon formed against our nation is going to prosper. And every word that rises up against our nation is going to be shown to be in the wrong, because you said this is our heritage as the righteousness of God. Father, I thank you for the word. I thank you for the blood of Jesus. It's a fountain that's always flowing. It's never stopped flowing. The blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus that saves, that redeems. Thank you, Father, for the blood. Thank you, we've been redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus. And it's never lost its power. It's never lost that power, that saving power, that cleansing power. And we thank you for the blood this morning, Father. That blood is still flowing. It's never stopped flowing. It's your blood. It's pure blood. It's righteous blood. It's holy blood. And we thank you for the blood of Jesus this morning. Oh, Father, we can stand in assurance because of what your word has promised us and what has been given unto us. We thank you for it, Father. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you for praise and worship. For all praise is a weapon. It is a weapon. Oh, and oh, Father, I thank you for praise. I thank you. You have endowed us with praise. Praise, to praise and to worship you, Father. And it steals the enemy. It can stop the enemy. Ooh, it can confuse the enemy as we praise you and we glorify you and we exalt you. So we know that we are fully equipped for these days that we're living in, Father. And I thank you that we know in whom we believe. And we know that you are well able to do exceedingly and abundantly above more that we could ask or think. Thank you for that this morning. Thank you that you are raising us up. You're raising us up into a place today, ooh, that you already saw today, that you already planned and purposed for today. So, Father, we just thank you that as we come before you in prayer, that we can come together as one voice this morning, knowing that you hear us when we pray. And we know that this is a confidence that we have, that when we pray according to your will, that you hear us. And when we know that you hear us, we know we have the petitions we've asked for. So we thank you for that today, Father. Thank you for this time that we've had, and oh, for so much more that you want to reveal and uncover to us in this day that we are living in. We love you, Father, and we thank you for your goodness, your mercy, your grace, your love, your forgiveness. And I thank you that it's a strong church, that Jesus is building his church. And we are seated in Christ right now. This is where our seating is. This is where we're seated today. In the heavenlies, at your right hand, spiritually, Father, that's our seating. And we are seated in that position of Jesus, his authority today. And so therefore we are seated far above principalities and powers and rulers of darkness in high places. Thank you for this seating that you have given to every single one of us in Christ Jesus. His seating of authority and all these things, principalities, powers, rulers of darkness, they're under our feet. They're under us because our seating is in Christ, in the heavenlies. So we thank you for that today, Father, with such thanksgiving in our hearts. And we love you. Thank you for every single one that's here. Father, I thank you there's going to be such a stirring in their spirit. They're going to have such a desire. They can't wait to get with others to pray. They can't wait to get to prayer meeting. They just can't wait because they know that they're going to be used by you. And they have a place in prayer with the Holy Spirit, who is our helper in prayer. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. And oh, Father, I'm going to pray for the services tomorrow morning. Oh, so thankful for all that you're doing in the church today, in Word Fellowship, but other churches. And Father, I want to thank you for moving mightily by your Spirit. And so we want to lift up the service tomorrow morning, Father, for the children, for the praise and worship team. Father, for Bart, who's going to minister, I thank you, you're going to give him words of life. And when he speaks forth in the morning, it's going to penetrate hearts. And Father, we just thank you for a mighty move of your Spirit in the morning, because we know that you are always welcome. You're always welcome to move and to minister as you will, Holy Spirit. So we thank you for great reports, Father, from tomorrow morning service. Thank you for the anointing upon this service tomorrow. Thank you for Brittany as she leads us in praise and worship, Father. All the musicians, everyone that is participating, Father, we just pray for them, for that anointing to come upon them. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. We thank you for today, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Well, thank you for coming. It's been a wonderful time. I truly believe, you know, he's really ministered to us this morning. I know he has. And so thank you for coming. And next month when we come together, I'm going to bring some scriptures. I'm going to bring a lot of things concerning about our nation, about how to pray for our nation. And I think I told you that my brother-in-law has the best prayer book, not just because he's my brother-in-law, but he's got his prayer books are powerful because it's the Word of God. And you know, when you pray the Word of God, it will not return void. And when you are praying the Word of God, you are praying the plan and purpose of God. And so he has a prayer book. It's for America. And you know, when he put that together, he said that the Spirit of God was dealing with him to get that book together. And he said he thought, well, you know, I haven't seen any on a prayer book for America, but he said, I'll do it. And he said, Rolene, he said, this was before 9/11. And as he was getting every prayer in there concerning our nation, the United States of America, there was one on terrorism. And he said, he thought, now that is really strange. He said, I'll tell you, he said, when the Spirit of God was showing me to do that and giving me the scriptures for it, and he said that was right before 9/11, and 9/11 happened right after that. He said, Ryan, I know the Holy Spirit was trying to show me ahead of time that we need to be praying against that because it was planned to happen. You know, that they were planning that. So I told you all it's out of print. I talked to him the other day. I told him, I said, please bring that book back into print, Cliff. And so I think maybe you can get on Amazon or thrift books, things like that, where you can buy a used one. But it is the most powerful prayer book on America. And I truly believe that book is for this time. I truly believe that. So you all are dismissed. Thank you for coming. It was such a blessing today. Praise the Lord. Continue to pray for me. I know I'm totally and 100% healed, but keep praying for me. And I know I have felt your prayers. I'm telling you, I really have. I know y'all been praying. The church has been praying for me. And so I've got too much to do. I can't be sitting back and not doing nothing. So thank you so much. Praise God. Oh, I do have something I want you to pray about. I've been asked to do a prayer conference in February. And I'm going up there. There's three ministries coming together, and they're putting this on. It's going to be their first prayer conference up there in Indiana. And so they're going to be pastors, and their prayer groups are all going to be coming. And I ask you to start praying for me now. Julia's going with me. Praise God. She's going to be going with me. And so I've got a text. They said they've got great expectation of what's going to happen. Got a lot of pastors coming, a lot of prayer groups coming from Illinois, Indiana, and Michigan. So if y'all will just pray, this is a first for me to be doing actually a prayer conference. I did one, well, I was there with their prayer group in one of the churches, but this is something that he's opened up. So if y'all will pray for me. And I love y'all. Have a wonderful, wonderful Christmas with your family.